Processed food is a very widely known topic. Everyone knows the amount of chemicals that are put inside the quote-unquote food is too much to count. To start, a chemical by the name of propylene glycol, it is a chemical used to make blueberry-flavored things. It is also used to clean your RV pipes after a muddy drive. You can see how just one of many examples is so repulsive, and just so quickly after knowing the real item it is used for. As you can see, the processed foods and sweets section was only at 11.6% of money spent on the groceries during the 1980s, but later in 2012, the chart showed the processed foods has dominated the market by raising to 22.9%. That may not seem like a lot, until you notice that it's above everything else. All of our necessary vitamins are inside those foods. They are key ingredients that help us live. If we don't get those necessary vitamins, we start taking supplements, and those contain a lot of highly concentrated vitamins. Soon, the healthy foods containing the vitamins aren't enough for your body. Also, with all the foods that are processed, they have multiple chemicals that are key factors to addiction and overdosing. Those chemicals have linked to cancer and neurological problems with the brain. Those chemicals are known as MSP and asparagus. Both are chemicals located not in just processed food, but in 80% of every single food that we eat.
But in reality, these chemicals are bad for you and do harm to your body. But these processed foods are consumed often because they have been modified to taste better. As people have come up with more processed foods over the years, they have been eaten a lot more by people, and therefore the calorie intake has increased over the years because people want to eat food that they think tastes good.
In conclusion, lots of these foods are not healthy for you. They lack the nutrients and vitamins in healthy food, and the added ingredients can do damage to your body. So, I know it's not possible to avoid these things, but just try to stay away.
Do you think we do anything like that connected with our faith? Pay more attention to things that taste good, seem good in our head, but ultimately may not necessarily be particularly nutritious to our faith? Do we spend too much time worried about whether or not something looks good or feels good, as opposed to wondering whether or not it actually is good? God gives us real food, but we settle for what is fake. God gives us real opportunities to exercise our faith, but we settle for our rationalization to inaction. God gives us real love that deals with us unconditionally, but we settle for lesser love tangled in strings. God gives us real hope that spans space and time, but we settle for trusting our own judgment and knowledge instead. My brothers and sisters in Christ, we need God's help to be satisfied with what God provides, with what God gives. And it begins with this simple truth. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Okay, I need four volunteers. No. It won't hurt. Stand here. Face the gallery. I need one more. So I have a task for you. Your job is to take that money, and I want you to go and get some ice cream with it.
It's not going to happen.
What?
It's not going to happen.
Why?
Because it's fake money.
How do you know that? It says 10.
It says 10
on it.
It says Monopoly. That's a game.
Oh, but people won't take that?
No.
Okay. But you don't even want to try?
No.
Okay, so you're saying you would rather use this?
Oh, yeah.
How do you know this is real?
It looks more real than this.
It looks more real than that?
People expect you to have that. They don't expect
you. How do you know I didn't just produce this on a copy machine?
Yeah.
Put a marker on it.
Yeah, when you see
because that's printed. So is this.
Right.
That's got this a number. That's got a number.
God, we trust
that's got a number 10 on it. This has got a 10 on it.
Oh man, that's this does not tell you God we trust,
don't it? Is that the kicker?
Makes it real.
Yeah, that's a little scary. So, why do you suppose then we do the same thing with our faith?
Easier sometimes.
How is it easier? Because you said this is a non-starter. Using the fake $10 isn't going to get you anything. Right? So why would we want that to be our starting place? Why not this? And ironically, why not in God we trust? Thank y'all. Very much. You know,
that's not what you're paying us for.
Not tonight. Well, but I mean, you, okay, so processed food. I mean, you hear the word, it's a little pejorative, right? But the truth is, there's a lot of processed food that's perfectly fine. It's good. We just talked about some just last week, baby food. Formula's processed. That jar of baby food is processed. We feed it to them like champs. Why not? Huh? It's, well, okay, still better than make your own. But, I mean, ultimately, we don't seem to have trouble feeding it to them.
Well, that's because all that it contains all natural ingredients. A lot of that stuff is not.
Yeah? So when you get like, fresh vegetables from the market, how many of you wash them when you get them home? Why do you do that? Oh, because they've been processed, even in the field. So, I mean, we got to avoid being hypocrites about this. Almost everything we eat is processed. Okay? So what we're really talking about is being choosy about, one, what kind of foods we're eating, two, how much processing we're willing to put up with, and so on. Right? There are factors. In some ways, it's a little bit like, and really, Philip, I have you to thank for this because you said it and it got my mind going. This phenomenon that we are calling now fake news. It's something that's been happening, though, right, since, I don't know, the earliest election you can probably remember. People, we find that the truth is a subjective thing. We have to collaborate because it becomes a function of what we believe. Doesn't it? I mean, it turns out even agreed upon truth is subjective. And it requires the collaboration of people. And if there's anything these election cycles have taught us in our lifetimes, it's that we will hold on to truth, to news that fits our sensibilities, and disregard or dismiss the rest. And as we suffer the information overload that we're living under, we have got to wonder, how do I tell what is real? How do I tell what's the truth? How do I know? So I want you to look at these and tell me what do you think these are? Okay, you know why there's a question mark after your answer? Because those are here. The next picture, these. You see that? They're onion rings next to chicken rings.
How do you make the chicken?
Oh, that's processed. That is an excellent question.
Why is the ring on a chicken?
I mean, you know, let's not be hypocrites. The onion rings are processed food. Okay? They're processed food. But dude. Chicken rings? Really? And, you know, as we look at them, I mean, how many of you would try them? I'm paying all of y'all in chicken rings. I know, they're dinosaurs. They're, you know, amoeba squares. They're all kinds of shapes. But, I mean, the truth is, there's no way you're going to ever convince somebody that that's what a chicken looks like. No matter how you slice it. And so, you know, it can be tempting, right, and simplistic to try and look at her faith this way. But there's a little bit more to trying to discern what is true than just recognizing that some things don't look right. Right? In Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, and then 13 through
17.
Well, really, the whole chapter. Paul is trying to make the argument that the Gentile church in Rome is really connected to the faith history of the Jews and to what God has been doing throughout history. He says, so what are we going to say? Are we going to find that Abraham is our ancestor on the basis of genealogy? Because if Abraham was made righteous because of his actions, he would have a reason to brag, but not in front of God. I mean, what does the scripture say? Abraham had faith in God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Workers' salaries, right, aren't credited to them on the basis of an employer's grace, but rather on the basis of what they deserve. But faith is credited as righteousness to those who don't work because they have faith in God, who makes the ungodly righteous. You with him so far? Okay, this is where it kind of gets a little convoluted, but stay with me. The promise to Abraham and to his descendants that he would inherit the world didn't come through the law, but through the righteousness that comes from faith. If they inherit because of the law, then faith has no effect and the promise has been canceled. The law brings about wrath. But when there isn't any law, there isn't any violation of the law. That's why the inheritance comes through faith, so that it will be on the basis of God's grace. In that way, the promise is secure for all of Abraham's descendants, not just for those who are related by law, but also for those who are related by the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have appointed you to be the father of many nations. So Abraham is our father in the eyes of God, in whom he had faith, the God who gives life to the dead and calls things that don't exist into existence. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So what is all that supposed to mean? And what are we supposed to do with that? Well, first of all, do you really think God singled Abraham out because he was a paragon of human virtue? Heck no. I'm just telling you. You know, when Abraham got this visit from the three messengers, the three angels, they told him, hey, you and Sarah are going to have a child. And he was like, wow, really? And after that happened, Sarah thought, well, you know, I'm pretty old. I'm pretty barren. So why don't you use my maidservant, Hagar, and maybe that's how this promise is supposed to take place, right? And, you know, Abraham didn't disagree, because you're talking about the same guy who passed his wife off as not as being his sister in order to get his own neck out of trouble. More than once. I know it's twice. I'm almost sure it was three times. I mean, unbelievable. The same thing. I mean, Abraham is all about himself, right? So what happens? Sarah gets jealous when she, in fact, does have a son. And she's watching Hagar's son grow up. And she's like, they're not going to be in the same house. And she tells Abraham, you need to kick them out. So Abraham banishes Hagar to the desert, which is a death sentence. It's a death sentence. And while they're at it, God tells Abraham, you got to prove your faith. So Abraham takes his only son to the top of this mountain, lays him on the wood, and is prepared to put a knife through him before God stops him. Abraham's not a paragon of virtue. And yet, he is called the father of faith. Why? Because he believed in God. And God counted it toward him as righteousness. Remember what chapter 4, verse 5 says. It says, but faith is credited as righteousness to those who don't work because they have faith in God who makes the ungodly righteous. It's something that happens to us, not something that we achieve. How many of you know the story, the Velveteen Rabbit? Okay. It really is a really great story, and I encourage you to read it. But in its chapters, there's a place at which the Velveteen Rabbit comes face to face with this very wise and very old hobby horse. They're going back and forth about what it really means to be a toy and what it means to be real. And the horse makes this statement to the rabbit, and he says, "Not that.
Not that."
There are two pictures in there.
I don't have that.
Well, basically,
sorry.
The horse says, you know you're going to be real when you get loved on and that love rubs all the hair off and you have broken and shabby parts. That's when you're real. But people who don't understand, when they look on the outside, they don't get it. They don't understand that you've been made real, but it's happened because you're loved. We are loved by God, and we are made righteous by God, but people on the outside might not understand because they don't see what God has done for us. They don't understand the depth of what God has forgiven. And so it becomes a question of, do we take this love for granted in what we choose to eat? I love this image of this skeleton of a fish. And these words, only when the last tree has died, the last river's been poisoned, the last fish has been caught, will we realize that we can't eat money. I'm just here to tell you, it's all monopoly money. It's all monopoly money. Because you can't eat this. And think about what that means for your faith. Think about what that means for how you go about conducting this life that God has given us to live. Now, look, let's be real. Sometimes we need to work these things out for ourselves. Okay? There's a story in this book that I love called The Spirituality of Imperfection. It's really a great book. It's a collection of vignettes from around the world. And one of the stories is this priest, and his disciples are walking along with him, and they get near this peach tree, and the disciples say, "Listen, how come you don't just give us the answers? Why are you always answering a question with a question and making us think?" And the teacher says, he takes a piece of the fruit off the tree. He takes a bite out of it. He says, "This peach is delicious." He said, "What would you prefer? That I take a bite out of it, chew it up, and spit that in your mouth? Or would you rather take a bite of the peach yourself?" Take a bite of the peach yourself, right? But the reality on the ground, right? Remember that hypocrisy thing. Not all processed food is bad, and raw is not always better. It isn't. Sometimes it matters who's in the kitchen cooking. Well, I mean, because look, I can eat asparagus all day long, but when it's sauteed with just the right amount of olive oil and some seasoning, And I could boil a pot roast and cook it so I kill all the germs and I can eat that. Or I could roast it, add some seasonings. Which do you prefer? Or would you just rather eat it raw because then you get connected with like the actual stuff of the cow? You're going to cook it, right? Think of it this way. How many of you think that it's important when, because this is one of the legacies that we've gotten in the Protestant church, everybody gets a Bible. Everybody gets to have the Bible in their hands. So let me just ask you, how many of you read your Bibles in Greek and Hebrew this week? Or any week? Anybody? Why not? That's getting back to the basics. That's getting back to the raw deal, the actual word, isn't it? Wait a minute. You all, how many of you read from English Bibles? Yeah, that's processed food. It's processed food. not all processed food is bad. In fact, the memories and the faith that the Israelites inherited that led them to write and to move to this pilgrimage song that we're about to read, all of that was processed for them. It was passed down from generation to generation. Psalm 121 says, I raise my eyes toward the mountains. Where will my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. God won't let your foot slip. Your protector won't fall asleep on the job. No, Israel's protector never sleeps or rests. The Lord is your protector. The Lord is your shade right beside you. The sun won't strike you during the day, neither will the moon at night. The Lord will protect you from all evil. God will protect your very life. The Lord will protect you on your journeys, whether going or coming, from now until forever from now. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I mean, there are some pretty heady promises in there. There's some big statements of faith. And as we move around our own mountains and we marvel at a God who could put such things together, a God who could put us together, a fake God simply won't do. We need God to be real, especially when we run into things like verse 7 of the psalm that says, the Lord will protect you from all evil. God will protect your very life. Now, what are we supposed to do with that? What do you think Jesus did with that while he was getting crucified? How many of you have ever been hurt before? How many of you have ever been frightened because of the harm that was about to be visited upon you? How many times have we marveled and wondered whether or not things like verse 7 can really be so? But if you'll notice in the verse, it's in the future tense. God will protect your life. It's a statement of faith. It's something that they were saying based on their experiences of God and what they hoped would happen. It's a pilgrimage prayer, just like we would do. It's a way to look at how God works in our life and to raise our expectations, because God's expectations of us are equally high. Yes, processed food is a fact of life. It is a part, not just of our diet, but it's a part of our thinking. It's a part of how we filter things. It's a part of how we even look at the world, right? But at the end of the day, we've got to be choosy about what filters we use. We need to be choosy about what we're ingesting. We need to be mindful about what kind of processed food we are using to nourish our faith, just as much as we're trying to be mindful about what processed foods we use to nourish or not nourish our bodies. My brothers and sisters in Christ, you are what you eat. Each week in Lent, we're going to end the sermon time, as I said, together with the same question. And the reason for this is to keep before us a really important concept as we move through this time of the sermon together. What are you feeding your faith? And so with this in mind, think and pray about the following this week. First, what are you doing to make sure God is the one in charge of your faith development? Did God choose the devotionals that you might use? Do you have God weighing in on the decisions you make about how you're going to participate in church? How is God involved in your faith development, in your growth? Second, how often are you discovering things for your faith for yourself versus allowing others to discover it for you? And remember, there's a place for both. There is. But are you mindful of those places where you are allowing someone else, me, Joel Osteen, whoever it is, to guide your thinking and understanding? And when are you digging in and trying to figure out things for yourself? Do you know the difference? Third, how do you know if your faith is real? How do you know if what you're feeding it is real? You know, when we talk about our mission efforts, they're a dime a dozen. There are lots of people asking you for money to do this or money to do that, to go into here. I mean, some of our folks just went to a Christian concert and they were getting hit up for that. Right? They're all over the place. How do you differentiate? Have you done your homework? How do you know what you're feeding your faith is real? And fourth, how do you know if you're submitting to God's will and not your own? Have you really ever sat down and thought about whether or not you're following God's will or just following your own? And if you're not sure, have you talked to anybody about it? Compare notes. But discern. So pay attention to what you're eating. Pay attention to who's doing the cooking. Pay attention and eat well, because God provides well. Get up and take heart. Jesus is calling you. Go and eat healthy.
Your praise.